Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. This morning we're going to talk about the title of our time together with gospel-centered parenting. And so I want us to take a few moments this morning and spend some time looking at biblical responsibilities of parents, specifically related in this passage of Scripture in Deuteronomy chapter 6. You say, well, I'm an empty nester. I don't have any kids. Well, if you're a grandparent, then I think these things would apply to you. If you're a Sunday school teacher, you're going to be that second level of spiritual discipleship in the lives of kids. And if you work with our youth, work with our children. But primarily, the text this morning deals with the responsibilities of parents. Specifically, I would say dads in the area of gospel-centered parenting. So pick up with me in Deuteronomy chapter 6. I'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. Here's what Moses says. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Let's pray. God, we are humbled and thankful for another opportunity to study your word. We come to a familiar passage of scripture, a passage of scripture that we have heard and studied. But I believe with all of my heart that there are some deep embedded truths in these verses that relate directly to us as parents and grandparents, specifically us as men in the home. So God, I pray that you will hide me behind the cross this morning. May the words that I speak not be mine, but may they be yours. We ask that Christ be exalted in this time together. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Parenting is tough and unique. You find yourself in interesting situations at times. I was reading the story of a family who, after church, was having guests over to their house for dinner. Lunch was being prepared. The family was trying to get everything situated. The kids were running around. The wife, mother, was trying to make sure everything was just perfect and the table was set. When they gathered together to sit down at the table, the father grabbed everyone's hand and said to little Johnny, would you pray for us? And Johnny said, I don't know what to say. And he said, well, just say the things that you've heard us say. And so he bowed his head and closed his eyes and said, dear God, I know we have a lot going on, and I don't know why these people are coming over for dinner today. But I pray you'll bless the food. They listen to what we say, right? We come to this familiar passage of Scripture in dealing with the area of parenting and gospel-centered parenting. The nation of Israel we've been following them as they've kind of walked outside and through to where they are now. We picked up with them in Genesis at the beginning. You know we're reading through the Bible this year, going all the way to Revelation in December. Now we're in Deuteronomy. We finished up Genesis. We watched the nation form. We got into Exodus, and we watched them leave out of the bondage and into headed towards the Promised Land. We read Numbers when they're all kind of numbered, literally kind of counted. And then last week, we stopped off with them at Kadesh Barnea, where they spent a good bit of time in Kadesh Barnea scouting out the Promised Land. And we talked about how the nation of Israel in that moment chose not to go and do what the Lord called them to do, but God allowed them to wander for 38 years. In fact, we studied this in the map here. I'll just point this out, a couple of things. One, if you'll remember, Kadesh Barnea is right here on the very edge of the Promised Land, that from where the nation of Israel was here in Egypt. And so for 38 or 40 40 years, the nation of Israel wandered around. And so you can see on the next map, possibly a little bit better, there's this region here called the Sinai Peninsula here where the Kadesh Barnea is right here where the nation of Israel wandered. This area here is about the size, if you draw a line between Memphis, Little Rock, and Fort Smith, North Arkansas, it's about the same square mile area as this. So imagine 2.5 million people for 38, 40 years wandering around in the area that would be kind of North Arkansas. In fact, I read an incredible article this week from a historian, archaeologist, who he would argue that the nation of Israel really didn't wander around this area. He would say they just stayed in this one spot. Whether they did, whether they didn't, but what happens is they're wandering around. Suffice to say, for 38 or 40 years, the nation of Israel doesn't make it into the promised land. We know from the scripture and the story we read at Kadesh Barnea where everybody who's north of 20, God says, you're not going to go into the promised land, you're going to die. And so for 38 or 40 years, we did some math Wednesday night, they were doing thousands of funerals every single week and burying the people north of 20 just in conservative numbers. And so the nation of Israel gets all the way back up here. Now we meet them up again in the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy is really Moses just giving one big long speech to the nation of Israel. But keep in mind who he's writing to. He's writing to the children of those whose parents and grandparents didn't go into the promised land. So as they stand here on the banks of heading into the promised land, and Moses is really farewell speech, he's giving them some words of encouragement. If you go back and read Deuteronomy, he's given kind of this historical lesson of this is how God provided here, this is what God did here, this is what God did here. And then you get to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and what you have is you have Moses gathering, I would say, the men together, the family leaders together, and saying, when you get into the promised land, and you get from where you are here at Kadesh Barnea, instead of wandering around for all this time, you're going into the promised land, there's something you're going to have to do once you get inside of there. And he really lays the burden of spiritual development on the shoulders of the parents here in Deuteronomy chapter 6. So what you're going to see is he doesn't bring in the religious leaders. He doesn't bring in the youth pastors. He doesn't bring in the children's directors. He doesn't bring in the pastors. He's talking to the parents here in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And he says to them in these verses, you now are the spiritual leaders of the people in your home. And if you're going to do this and have gospel-centered families, he really says you're going to have to do two things. And so let's go back to the text and just unpack what he says. First, he says, if you're going to have gospel-centered families, then the first thing you're going to have to do is you're going to have to pursue the Lord God completely. If you and I are going to have gospel-centered families here in Jacksonville or around the world, wherever we live, the first thing we're going to have to do is to pursue the Lord God completely. Go back to the text and just notice the first three verses here. The first thing he talks about in verse 4 is almost this deference, this attitude or this heart of submission to a holy and righteous sovereign God. Notice what he says in verse 4. He says, hear, O Israel. The Hebrew word there really is obey. He's saying to them, obey Israel. And then he says, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. I mean, this deference of the sovereignty of God in this humble submission to God. Notice what he says. He says in the verse, he says, hear, O Israel, the Lord, which is Hebrew for Yahweh. He says, Yahweh is our Elohim. The Yahweh is one. The Lord, the Yahweh here is singular, identifying the God in which we serve would be singular. But he says, as our God, Elohim, which is plural, which is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But our God is one and singular in nature. So we live in a culture and a world today that believes in this kind of plurality of gods, right? I mean, the nation of Israel was going to go from where they were, wandering around in Kadesh Barnea from the Egyptians, going into the promised land with the Canaanites, the Hittites, and all the other groups, and there was going to be a temptation to worship multiple gods. There was going to be this temptation to identify Baal, the Asherah, and others that would be the god in which they worship. But Moses says to them, listen, when you get over there, you're going to have to pursue the Lord your God completely, and part of your pursuit of identifying the Lord God is that your pursuit is singular in nature, that it's Yahweh and Yahweh only that you pursue. It's not this God or that God or this level or that level. It is the pursuit of Yahweh God and Yahweh God only. But not in just their deference of submission to the singular pursuit of God himself. Notice next he talks about the devotion, right? I mean, keep going in verse 5. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with what? Three things, right? He talks about their heart. The heart is the seat of who they are inside, their emotions, their driving factor within them. So he says, you're to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your might. In other words, in this pursuit of the Lord God completely in your personal life, you're going to have to pick God and worship him and him only, but you're not going to do it partially. You're not going to do it just a little here and a little there. You're not going to honor him with this part of your life, but not honor him with this part of your life, but you're going to honor him with every single part of who you are. The totality of the pursuit of God for the nation of Israel at this moment, Moses is saying to them, you can't go into the promised land and go every which way. You can't go after this God and worship it and worship this God with this and worship this God with this. It's this humble submission to the Lord, sovereign God, that every single part of who you are, you're going to worship and serve them. That you're going to pursue the Lord with your heart, with your soul, and with your might. And so as we begin to kind of unpack and get into the dirt a little bit, what you see here in the scripture is Moses saying to the nation of Israel, when you're home and where you are, love the Lord with every single part of who you are and what you're doing. You teach your kids that. Teach your kids that it doesn't matter what you do, what they do, or where they are. They can honor the Lord in any pursuit of what they have. You know, yesterday afternoon, we were in the car with my wife and three daughters. Carter was with my sister and her family. We were in the car, and we began to talk about with Summer, Tilly, and Story where they were going to go to college. Well, they're in the first, second, and third grade, so I thought it was a little early, but we talked about this is where you can go to college, and we began to explore. Tilly said, I want to go to college. I want to be a veterinarian. And I thought, okay, that's great. Tilly has said that for a long time. And so the thing about Tilly is when she puts her mind to it, like, get out of the way, because that's what's going to happen. And so she has decided she wants to be a veterinarian. I think in 20 years, then she'll be a veterinarian. Summer said, I want to grow up and be a missionary. And so we talked about what it meant to grow up and be a missionary. She said, I want to go to Ouachita. They have a good school. I want to go there. Tilly wanted to go to a veterinarian school where they could do veterinarian stuff. Summer wanted to go to Ouachita because she wanted to be a missionary when she grows up and just kind of loving the Lord as a missionary, loving the Lord as a veterinarian. And Story popped up from the back row and she said, I want to go to Chick-fil-A for college. And we were like, I think that's a great place to go to college. That's by far the cheapest of the three options. We'll even upsize your meal. And so Tilly, so first grade, she's going to college at Chick-fil-A. And so, but we want to teach our kids that whether they're a veterinarian or whether they're a missionary or whether they're eating lunch at Chick-fil-A, they're to love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. That whether they are an accountant or whether they're a teacher or whether they're an administrator, whether they work in the corporate world or whether they are a stay-at-home mom, they can love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that's what he's saying to the nation of Israel. He says, look, when you get over there, there is one God and one God only, and that's Yahweh. Our Yahweh God is the one in which we pursue. And we're going to pursue him, not partially, but we're going to pursue him totally with every single fiber of who we are and what we do. But not just in our deference, not just in our devotion. Notice what he talks about in their dedication. He says in verse 6, these words shall be on, I'm commanding you today, shall be on your heart. Now, I have to be honest with you, this is the phrase over the last few weeks as we've been studying and putting all this together that really I've kind of found myself kind of couched in. What does it mean for these commandments? What does it mean for the Word of God to be completely on our heart? What does it mean for the Word of God, for my heart to marinate in the Scriptures morning, noon, and night? What does it mean for the Scriptures and the commandments of God to be on our hearts? Read this quote with me on the screen. Jerry Marcellino, in his wonderful little booklet, Rediscovering the Lost Treasures of Family Worship, says this about this very point. He says, So often, a child sees behind all the religious garb of his parents and finds what is really precious to them. He sees patterns of heart which lure them toward a pursuit of wealth, leisure, athletics, entertainment, television, shopping, and religious business. A child can easily see when these things are more exciting to his parents than devotion to Jesus Christ. When this proves to be the case, a child will embrace those same affections to the detriment of his own soul. However, when children see parents who pant after God, parents who were constantly poring over the scriptures, going to God in prayer about everything. Parents who have a proper balance between the enjoyment of legitimate recreation and seeking to conform to everything that would bring glory to God, their children can be expected to adopt the same balance. Listen to this. He says, whatever or whoever is precious to you, the same will be precious to your children. And that's just true, right? Your kids are watching your pursuits. They're watching the things that you drive after, the things that you pursue. They're mimicking what you do and what they see at home. And what he says in the book here is he says the things that your children watch you and observe you doing will become the pattern in which they live their life. If they watch a parent who is so enamored and focused on grades and wealth and success and all of these other things, then that will become their driving force in their life. That will become the thing that drives them through junior high, high school, college, and young adult years. If they see you and I as parents pushing behind them all the success and things of the world and the pursuit of the things in which we live in and not allowing the word of God to begin written on our heart in our singular purpose of God and God alone and loving him with every single fiber of our being, those things that are important to us as we parent will become important to them. So I'm just saying to us in this overwhelming conviction place in my life, as Moses looks at the nation of Israel at this moment and he says, listen, when you go into the promised land, your kids are going to be watching you. When you go into the promised land, little Johnny, little Betty, little Sally, and little Sue are going to be watching you, and they're going to be paying attention to you, and they're going to be observing you. And the things that are driving you, pushing you, and that you are passing on to them will become what drives and fuels them within them. And the greatest thing that you and I can place on them is a pursuit not of things of the world, but is a pursuit of the greatness and the glory of God in their life. So he says, when you get over there, pursue God with every single part of who you are and allow these words to be written deep into the hallways of your heart. Just an overwhelming conviction in my life with my four kids. And as I look at the young parents within our families, we're having babies and all these things pouring in here, is I just want to stand up and say through the word of Moses on the authority of scripture, you pursue the Lord your God with everything. Teach your kids how to pray. Teach your kids how to read the Bible. Teach your kids how to pursue the Lord. Teach your kids how to honor God with all your strength, all your might, all your soul. Teach your kids how to do that because your kids are watching you. They're paying attention to you. And so he says, listen, pursue the Lord your God completely. Write them on your hearts and train your children. But not just pursue the Lord your God completely. Second, he says, invest in your children intentionally. Invest in your children intentionally. Go to verse 7. Now, I want you to come in here real close because I want you to see what the Bible says in these three verses. He says, the very first word of verse 7 is what? You. This primary responsibility of spiritual discipleship in your home, Dad, is on you. In fact, you say, I don't know. If you take verse 7, verse 8, and verse 9, and you circle every time you see the word you or your, you're going to come up with 13 different times. 13 different times. Moses says to the men here in this moment, you teach them. You teach them. You talk about them. You write them. You mention them. You. You bind them. You write them. This is your primary responsibility. I was reading this week an article that I came across, fascinating. An article written by a guy by the name of Clark Forbes, written March 13th, 2017. The title of the article from Radical Resources, David Platt's ministry, is entitled, Don't Farm Out Your Child's Discipleship to the Youth Pastor. And the article is writing about the role of the youth pastor in relationship to the parents and the spiritual discipleship of children. He writes this, nothing helps a teenager know the gospel like seeing it modeled in the home. Not just taught or spoken to them, but modeled through their parents' relationship to each other and to the kids. But listen to these quotes. Here's the first one. It's easy to tell a teenager who has parents actively discipling them from those who don't. It's rare to find a student that cares deeply about the gospel with parents who do not also care deeply about the gospel at home. He goes on to say, "Too often, I face the sad reality of Christian parents who are spiritually absent from their kids. They see their role as Christian parents primarily as taking their kids to church, but it often stops there. What's modeled in the home is not a priority and a commitment to Jesus, but a priority and commitment to success, to wealth, and to good grades. Parents focus on the life success of their kids while they leave the spiritual success to the church." He says, "Church is indeed vital to the growth of a Christian. More parents should do well to make church a greater priority. Discipleship for your children must, at a minimum, involve the local church. We rarely see students grow up to love Jesus who don't also grow up loving the local church." He says, "Parents need the support of other parents of the church community and of the ministry, but the main arena of discipleship for a child is not in the church through the youth pastor, but in the home through the parent." To which I would say, amen. Moses didn't gather all the youth people together and say, "You make sure you have great Wednesday night activities so the kids will love Jesus more." He didn't say to the children's person, "Make sure we have the best children's area so the kids will love Jesus more." He didn't say to the Sunday school teachers or to this people. He's speaking to the parents, and he's saying to the moms and dads, to the dads particularly who's sitting there, "You teach them. You." He doesn't gather the pastors and say, "Have cute sermons with great this and neat this so that the people will leave after 30 minutes once a week and love Jesus more." He says to the parents, "You are the primary responsible person in the spiritual development of the children in your life. It's you." Then I thought about this. You and I will never teach our kids to love Jesus more than we love Jesus. I can't. I can't teach Carter, Summer, and Tilly, and Story Odell to love Jesus any more than I love Jesus. And you can't teach the kids in your home to love Jesus any more than you love Jesus. And they're watching how much you love Jesus. They're paying attention to how much you pursue Jesus. They're paying attention to how much you pray to Jesus. They're paying attention to how much you involve in your heart and your pursuit of Jesus. And he says to them, "You teach them. It's your primary responsibility." But then I dig a little deeper further into the text, and I came across a word that I've just basically fallen in love with. He says in verse 7, "You shall teach them how." The word there is diligently. So I began to do some study on what does the word diligently mean in the language of the Old Testament. And then I figured it out. This is my knife. I have a pocket knife here. I'm a trained professional, so no one worry. This is my pocket knife, and these are what you call a whetting stone, W-H-E-T-T-I-N-G. Stay with me. The root word of the word diligently there in the Hebrew is shanan. The word shanan means whetting or sharpening. Stay with me. Here's what you have. Diligently, the Hebrew word, shanan, to wet, to sharpen, to pierce, to inoculate. When I want to sharpen this knife, this is what I do. I take the whetting stones, and really I call Bill Summers and say, "Can you sharpen them?" But this is what I would do. I would take my knife, and I would take these stones, and I would start rubbing it in a circular manner, right? I would take the dull side of my knife, and I would take this whetting, and I would start sharpening it, and I would rub it continuously. And I would sharpen it. And then I would make sure the whetting stone was wet, and I would sharpen it. And when that side was sharpened, I would take the dull side of my knife, and I would sharpen it. That is the word that Moses is using here when he says, You have a responsibility at your home as a parent, as a leader in your home, to sharpen the spiritual appetite of the children within your home, to diligently sharpen them. And when they're dull, you sharpen them. And when they're dull, you sharpen them, and you sharpen them, and you sharpen them, and you sharpen them. That my job and my house and my spiritual responsibility with Carter, Summer, Tilly, and Story and yours at your house is to be the sharpening agent of the heart of the children in your home. And when your children are spiritually dull, you're to sharpen them. And when your children are spiritually lethargic, you sharpen them. And when your children are spiritually disinterested, you're sharpening them. You're sharpening them. You're sharpening them. And you are constantly the primary sharpener of the people who live in your home. You are constantly sharpening them. And so I say to you this morning, on the authority of the Word of God, that the spiritual sharpness of your children is your responsibility. The primary person is to spiritually sharpen them, to cause them to have a sharper, passionate desire in pursuit of the Lord. The issue goes back to the very beginning. If you and your relationship are not pursuing God completely and passionately and singularly, then you're not going to be able to sharpen the hearts of those in your home. You're not going to be able to sharpen the hearts of the children in your home. They're going to continue to remain dull because your pursuit is in things of the world and not in things of God. William Lane Craig, who is an incredibly intelligent man, a Christian apologetic, wrote this. In high school and college, Christian teenagers are intellectually assaulted with every manner of non-Christian worldview coupled with an overwhelming relativism. If parents are not intellectually engaged with their faith and do not have sound arguments for Christian theism and good answers to their children's questions, then we're in real danger of losing our youth. It's no longer enough to simply teach our children Bible stories. They need doctrine, apologetics. It's hard to understand how people today can risk parenthood without having studied apologetics or doctrinal issues. Just put it all together. What was Moses saying to the nation of Israel? You're responsible. We're going into the promised land. You have a covenant responsibility with the blessings that God's blessed you with in the children to raise them up, to diligently sharpen them, to diligently rub them on the whetting stone and give them a sharp heart and towards spiritual things in their pursuit of the Lord. It's a reflection of your pursuit of God. The Lord your God is one God. It's a singular focus. You're to love your Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, with everything about you, and you're to take these commandments and write them on your heart, and then you be the spiritual leader within your house. You say, well, David, I don't know how to do that. Well, I'm glad you asked and made the comment. Go back to the text and notice what he says. Verse 7. He says, you shall teach them diligently to your sons. How do you do it? Notice the three areas. He says, you shall teach them when you talk of them. When you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up, you're talking about it. You're having, John, gospel conversations with your children. When you're sitting in the morning, just notice the progression of the day. He talks about when you rise up in the morning, when you get up out of bed and you're sitting in your Cocoa Puffs and you're on your way, do you have a gospel conversation with your kids? When you're sitting in traffic, when you're sitting at stoplights, when somebody is sitting in different areas, do you have gospel conversations with your children? Do you have gospel conversations with your kids when you're sitting at the house, when you're in the backyard, when you're just doing day-to-day activities, do you have gospel conversations with your kids? Not just in the morning, not just in the day, but notice what he says in the text at the very end. When you lie down at night, the totality of the day, you are constantly having gospel conversations with your children. That there's not a moment in your day that you're not talking about the gospel or God or the faithfulness of the Lord in your life to your kids. Can I ask you a question, Dad? When's the last time you had a gospel conversation with your children? When's the last time you sat with your kids and talked about the gospel? When's the last time you sat and talked with your son about the gospel and the relationship to moral purity? When's the last time you had a gospel conversation with your daughter and how it affects her life and the things that are going on with them? When's the last time you had a gospel conversation with the events and the things that are going on in your kid in junior high and high school? Well, that's just the youth guy will take care of that. Oh, just the children's person. No, when's the last time you in your life, in your spiritual development, had a gospel conversation with the children that the Lord has entrusted you with? And he's saying you have to invest in your kids intentionally. You just can't throw it up in the air and hope it all works out. No, you're pouring yourself into your kids. But I again go back, if I may, one more time and say, you will only be able to pour into your kids what you've been poured into in your pursuit of the Lord. And if you are empty and dry in your pursuit of the Lord, you will have nothing to pour into your kids. And so if you're not pursuing the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, you in no way, shape, or form will be able to pour yourself into your kids. You'll get in the car and you'll turn the radio on. And I'm as guilty as this as absolute anybody in this room. And you check out. You turn the radio on and you just hope to drown out the craziness. You put everybody in their room at night, hoping that they'll just go to sleep, remove all knives and guns and put everybody in their bed. Like, we're all guilty of that. I told my wife, I said, I'm just overwhelmingly convicted that my responsibility is to have gospel conversations with my kids and developing them. But not just that, notice what else he says. In verse 8, he says, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. The idea behind this area of authority, that the scripture has the authority as a sign in your life, that there's they're written, they're bound, they're part of the decision-making processes of your life. In verse 8, he says, you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. That every area of your home is saturated with gospel presence, the commandments of God, and the words of God. I mean, just step back and put all this together. Moses is saying to them, you guys are heading to the promised land. You guys are going over to the promised land. When you get to the promised land, you are going to have to spiritually and gospelly saturate your children and your family. That every conversation you have, every opportunity you have, that the authority, that it's visible, that it's physical, that you see the commandments and the word of God. When's the last time you read the Bible with your kids, Dad? When's the last time the word of God became this vital part of your relationship with your kids? You cannot just hope and wish and pray that your kids will grow up and be spiritually mature and leaders in the church and wash your hands of it and walk away, cross your fingers, cross your eyes, and wish on a star. You can't do that. We're living in a generation today of children who are rising up, growing up, who have spiritually disinterested parents. And the product of it? Just look across the landscape of our churches. Young people, children, youth, I'm right there with you. I literally am right in the boat with you. There are some days where I'm like, man, I'm going to be a good dad. Then there are other weeks where I'm like, oh my goodness, how am I going to do this? But I can tell you this, my children are only going to be as spiritually sharp as I sharpen them. When I talk, I'm sharpening the knife. And when I lay them down at night, I'm sharpening the knife. And when we drive to school, I'm sharpening the knife. And when we're going through circumstances and making decisions, I'm sharpening the knife. I'm sharpening the knife. I'm sharpening the knife. So I leave you with something. You say, David, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to start. You're here and you're like, man, David, it wasn't modeled for me at my house. I didn't have a mom or a daddy who loved Jesus. I don't know where to start. Can I give you a starting point? I have down here on the front, on the stage here, a sheet of paper that's entitled, Pray for Your Children. There's 31 ways on that sheet of paper that you can pray for your children. You can pray for their mind. You can pray for gospel influence. You can pray for their purity. You can pray for a number of things. And in a moment, when we had our invitation, maybe at the end of church, you want to come grab one of those sheets of paper. And you say, I don't know where to start, but I know this, I'm going to pray. And you're like, David, I don't have any kids in my house. You got grandkids? Pick up that sheet of paper, take it home, and one day, just pray, 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 pray. Pray for the children in our church who don't have moms and dads who bring them to church. Pray for the children in our community. But pray, pray, pray. So I ask you two questions as we leave. First, are you pursuing the Lord your God completely? Is God, Yahweh, our Elohim, Yahweh, the only God in your life? Or is it your job? Is it the bank account? Is it that promotion? Are you pursuing the Lord your God completely? If you removed everything else from your life that's impacting your pursuit of the Lord. And then two, dads, may I ask you a question? Are you spiritually sharpening your children. You, spiritually sharpening them. When you walk, when you lie down, when you stand up. I don't have it all together when it comes to parenting, and I have a long way to go. But I can tell you this, my kids are watching me. They're watching how I talk to their mom. They're watching when we go to bed, when we get up. They're watching everything in my life. And Dad and Grandpa, can I say this to you? Your kids and grandkids are watching you too. And they're paying attention. Do they see someone who is passionately pursuing the Lord and is intentionally investing in them?